This channel has been established for visually impaired people. For the visually impaired people, voice narration and a written expression are also provided for the hearing impaired. Don't forget to subscribe to our channel. The blockade runners of the American Civil War were seagoing steamships that were used to make their way through the Union blockade that extended some 3,500 miles 5,600. By the end of the Civil War, the Union Navy had captured more than 1,100 blockade runners and had destroyed or run aground another 355 vessels. Contents 1 Background 2 Union Blockade 3 Supplying the Confederacy 31 Central Figures 311 Josiah C. Gorgas 312 Caleb Hughes 313 James Dunwoody Bullock 314 John Newland Moffat 4 Blockade Runners 41 The First Blockade Runners 5 Notable Blockade Runners 6 See also 7 Bibliography 71 Primary sources 72 Further reading 8 Notes 9 References 10 External links Background When the American Civil War broke out on April 12, 1861, the newly formed Confederate States of America had no ships to speak of in its navy in the months leading up to the war. The Confederate government was well aware of the naval supremacy of the North and sought the help of Great Britain, which had great interests in the plantations of the South. The British became the primary ship builders and sources of supply for the Confederate government for the duration of the Civil War. Several courses of action soon developed in 1861. The Southern fleet only consisted of about 35 ships, of which 21 were steam-driven. The Confederacy was also in dire need of many basic supplies, and without the resources of the industrial North, it had to look to other venues for its supplies coming to their aid. An experienced and former U.S. naval captain, Raphael Semmes, devised a plan by which to thwart the naval supremacy of the North. He proposed a militia of privateers which would both strike at the North's merchant ships and provide supplies to the South by outrunning or evading the ships of the Union blockade. Confederate President Jefferson Davis approved of the plan. On April 15, President Lincoln issued his first proclamation, calling out 75,000 troops in response to the Confederate bombardment of Fort Sumter. On April 17, Davis issued a proclamation, offering a letter of marque to anyone who would offer their ship in the service of the Confederacy. To this end, British investors were the most prolific in offering such aid. The North refused to recognize the sovereignty of the Confederacy along with its right to issue letters of marque, and in little time on April 19, Lincoln issued a second proclamation, threatening the Confederacy with a blockade along its coastlines, i.e., Scott's Anaconda Plan extended along the Atlantic and the Gulf of Mexico coastlines and up into the lower Mississippi River. Lincoln's proclamation also contained a threat that any actions against the Union by crews of ships acting under a Confederate letter of marque would be treated as pirates and subject to prosecution for such crimes, which usually called for the death penalty. In response, Davis countered with threats of retaliation, while the British also proclaimed its refusal to concur with Lincoln's proclamation in nearby Nassau and its territorial waters. Blockade run mail to New Orleans via Nassau, Bahamas, stamped incoming ship 10 cents postage due. Lincoln's proposed blockade was met with mixed criticism among some of his contemporaries. Thaddeus Stevens angrily referred to it as a great blunder and absurdity, arguing that we were blockading ourselves and in the process would be recognizing the Confederacy as a belligerent of war. Soon after Lincoln announced the blockade, the profitable business of running supplies through the blockade to the Confederacy began. At first, the actual blockade was slow to materialize, as the task of patrolling thousands of miles, 6,000 kilometers of coastline, was enormous, and the blockade was considered by some to be little more than a paper blockade. Wilmington, North Carolina was not blockaded until July 14, 1861, 3 months after Lincoln's proclamation. An enormous naval industry evolved which brought great profits for shipbuilders, shippers, and suppliers alike throughout the conflict. Mail was carried also by blockade runners to and from ports in the West Indies, Nassau, and Bermuda, but soon federal forces began to more effectively enforce the coastal blockade and established squadrons at the various southern ports, while also setting up roving patrols just outside British territorial waters in the Caribbean, most notably in the Bahamas. As the risk of capture or destruction increased, amateur blockade runners began to cease operations, with most of the trade now being handled by courageous sea captains who were soon using specially made steamers that allowed them to evade or outrun Union ships on blockade patrol. Union blockade 1861 characterized map of Scott's blockade plan. General Winfield Scott was one of the few senior men in Washington who realized that this could be a long war, and he developed an appropriate naval strategy that would make a decisive impact on the war's outcome. This was part of his famous Anaconda plan that employed a naval blockade around the coastline of the Confederacy with the idea of adversely affecting its economy and supply lines because of the thousands of miles of coastline, 6,000 kilometers, with its many rivers, bays and inlets. The blockade proved largely ineffectual during the first couple of years of the war. This allowed blockade runners to import military supplies to the Confederacy with relative ease. Deliveries of armaments and military supplies to the South and cotton to England were coordinated by military agents like Major Walker, who played a key role in supplying the con agent. Lincoln's proclamation raised issues with England and other powers relating to international law in the midst of a naval blockade. The Confederacy received an almost steady supply of arms and other goods from Europe, along with mail at the same time. It was exporting cotton and other commodities to France and England, whose textile industries were greatly dependent on these southern exports. Outgoing runners would also carry mail during the course of the Civil War. Most of the attempts to run the blockade succeeded, but as the months passed, the captains and crews on blockade patrol became more seasoned and grew wiser to the various tactics employed by blockade runners during the last 2 years of the war. The only vessels capable of getting through the blockade were the blockade runners that were specifically designed for speed during the first year of the Civil War. The southern ports in the Gulf of Mexico experienced a great deal of blockade running activity in the first 10 months. New Orleans, Louisiana, the largest cotton port in the world, gave port to more than 300 blockade runners when New Orleans fell to Union forces on April 25, 1862. The center for blockade running activity shifted to Mobile, Alabama, with New Orleans and the Mississippi River secured. Blockade efforts by the Union Navy along the Gulf Coast were greatly increased, forcing blockade runners to use the port at Galveston, Texas, when Mobile and its port came under siege in the summer of 1864. All activity there moved to Galveston. Blockade runners used Havana as a stopover point for transferring cargoes to and from neutral ships supplying the Confederacy. The newly formed Confederacy CSA was not officially recognized by the various foreign powers, a situation that led the seceded states to seek the aid of various private shipping companies and other businesses, especially overseas where there was interest and willing compliance to sell and ship the much-needed supply and ordnance to the Confederacy to handle its important supply dealings and various business affairs. The Confederate government turned to John Fraser. Before war broke out, military arms for the CSA states were in short supply. There was also little gunpowder stored among the seceded states, and the availability of fuses and percussion caps was also very limited, the caps in the South amounting to only a half a million. There was no machine to produce them in any of the Confederate states. Powder supplies in Florida were so low that, in April 1861, General John B. Grayson warned Jefferson Davis in Richmond, "As sure as the sun rises, unless cannon powder, etc., be sent to Florida in the next 30 days, she will fall into the hands of the North. Nothing human can prevent it." The same urgent demand for military ordnance and supplies was dispatched to Richmond from every military center throughout the South because of the incursions of the Union Army. The Confederate Navy was also in very short supply of coal, with the only domestic sources being located in North Carolina and Alabama. The well-funded Importing and Exporting Company of Georgia was founded in 1863 by Gozaway Bug Lamar, a Wall Street banker who had returned to his native Georgia at the outbreak of hostilities. At this time, the Confederate government depended almost entirely on privately owned blockade runners. However, the leaders of the Confederacy had enough foresight to realize that the Federation needed its own vessels to bring in supplies. Acting for the Confederate Navy Department, James Dunwoody Bullock began procuring vessels in Europe, most notably the CSS Atlanta, which made its famous run into Savannah carrying 10,000 Enfield rifles, 1 million cartridges, 2 million percussion caps, and 400 barrels of gunpowder, along with swords, revolvers, and other military supplies. Central figures coordinating the business affairs of the CSA with shipbuilders, purchasing agents, suppliers, and shippers in Liverpool, Nassau, Wilmington, and other ports involved the concerted efforts of a number of notable men and shipping firms. Foremost in this effort were Major Josiah C. Gorgas and Fraser, Trenholm and Company, who worked closely with Gorgas, the Confederate Naval Secretary, and other agents Major Josiah C. Gorgas. Josiah C. Gorgas, because the South lacked the industrial resources of the North, it was forced to seek military supplies from other, often overseas, sources. Blockade runners became the chief means of supplying the blockaded Confederacy. Ships of the Confederate Navy used for running the blockade were employed by Confederate Chief of Ordnance, Major Josiah Gorgas, a West Point graduate of 1841 who prior to the war had worked in the United States Ordnance Bureau and had served in nearly every arsenal in the nation. While working in the South, he became sympathetic to the secessionist movement and eventually sided with the Confederacy, becoming the head of the Confederate Ordnance Bureau. Gorgas liaised with Charles Priolo, who headed Trenholm's Liverpool office, arranging for the shipping of arms and other supplies. Most of the arms sent to the Confederacy departed from Liverpool during the summer of 1861. Gorgas stockpiled supplies and prepared his first load of cargo, while Trenholm's company procured a suitable ship for the voyage. A 1,200-ton iron-hulled steamer, the Bermuda, was chosen to make the voyage. Caleb Hughes to coordinate the business and the buying of weapons and supplies in England. Gorgas relied on agents Captain Caleb Hughes and Major Edward C. Anderson. Under Gorgas' direction, Hughes served as an arms procurement agent and purchasing specialist, well known for his successful acquisition of weapons contracts with various European nations, including the United Kingdom and Austria. Among others, Anderson was also sent to aid Hughes and check on his activity. Hughes arranged the sale and procurement of rifles and other ordnance from the London Armory Company, which became the chief supplier of arms to the Confederacy throughout the war. By February 1863, the armory had shipped over 70,000 rifles to the Confederacy. Hughes was also owner of several seagoing steamers used in blockade running and made several trips to Europe and back aboard these vessels. While in Europe, Hughes represented the Confederate War Department and Ordnance Bureau throughout the entire war and arranged for credit to be extended when funds were short. These men also acted as liaisons with Charles Priolo of Fraser, Trenholm. In 1863, Bullock contracted with the Laird Shipyard for the construction of two ironclad rams to be used against the Union blockade. However, if it could be proven that the contract or commission for building these ships was in violation of Britain's neutrality law, the ships could be seized. The Union's minister to Britain, Charles F. Adams, tried to do just that, but he could only gather circumstantial evidence. As Bullock went to great lengths to conceal his movements, Adams threatened the British government with reprisal, that if the rams escaped, the United States would consider it an act of war. After further consideration, British authorities seized the two vessels and from that point on kept a close watch on Bullock and other such propositions made by the Confederate government, forcing CSA officials to turn to the French for future commissions. Following that turn of events, Bullock then commissioned a shipbuilder in France to construct the Stonewall, and other armored ram, John Newland Moffat. On April 11, 1862, George W. Randolph, the new Confederate Secretary of War, appointed John Newland Moffat, an officer of the Confederate Navy and a notorious privateer with a long success record, to be the acting agent in Nassau for the Confederacy. Nassau was one of several offshore stopover points for shipments coming into or leaving the Confederate States. Moffat's duties were broad. You are authorized to take entire control of all vessels loaded with arms and munitions for the Confederate States. Moffat's duties included selecting ports of entry and discharging and replacing officers and crews as needed. His only condition was that he first confer with Lewis Halinger, Confederate agent in Nassau. Moffat would later be given command of the CSS Albemarle Blockade Runners, CS Ella. Confederacy Wilmington on the Cape Fear River, Charleston Harbor. See also First and Second Battles of Charleston Harbor. Mobile Bay. The first outbound blockade runner to elude the blockade made its way to Nassau, landing there on December 5, 1861. Blockade runners would typically export cotton to Nassau, where it would be stored, then transferred to a neutral ship and sent to England, usually Liverpool. By the end of the war, 397 ships sailed from the Confederacy to Nassau, and 588 went from Nassau to the Confederacy. Oftentimes vessels departing from various ports in Bermuda ran to Wilmington and Charleston, from where most of the supplies were then shipped by rail to Augusta, the main depot for the Western armies, or to Richmond, the main Eastern depot. Imports shipped to Galveston were also sent by rail to Houston. By 1863, Union attacks along the Confederate coast made running the blockade more difficult, forcing blockade runners to use other ports besides those at Wilmington, Charleston, and Savannah. After the capture of New Orleans in 1862, the ports in Mobile and Galveston were the next choice, used in conjunction with Havana as a transfer Point. Unlike Charleston and Savannah, Wilmington was the central depot for blockade runners throughout most of the Civil War. The Union made several attempts to stop the ships coming and going, but it proved to be a futile effort, as the blockade runners were built for speed. This was made plainly evident on December 23, 1864, when the largest Union fleet ever to assemble in the Atlantic attacked Fort Fisher, a massive fortification protecting the Cape Fear River entrance and Wilmington, while the fleet of 125 men of war and transport were blockading the harbor. An incoming blockade runner passed through the fleet and took refuge upriver. The last blockade runner to make its way into Wilmington's port was the SS Wild Rover. On January 5, 1865, the fort was attacked a second time on January 13, and after a two-day siege it was captured on January 15 by the Union Army and Navy. Several blockade runners previously docked upriver managed to escape in the midst of the battle prior to the capture of the fort. Rear Admiral Porter, in command of the Eastern Flotilla, wrote to the War Department, "Blockade running seems almost as brisk as ever. The new class of blockade runners are very fast and sometimes come in and play around our vessels. They are built entirely for speed." Eventually, Union attacks were also being made along the Bermuda coast, where Union man of war ships often seized neutral vessels and their cargoes. This outraged Lewis Haliger, who was appointed by the Treasury of the Confederacy as head of the Depository of Confederate funds in Nassau, Bahamas. Among his chief duties was to coordinate shipments of cotton and tobacco to England, and to organize and conduct the purchase of incoming cargoes. The first blockade runners, soon after Lincoln's proclamation, blockade runners were being produced. Lighter vessels specifically designed to evade and outrun Union ships on blockade patrol. Many of the vessels were built in English shipyards and were designed to be used as fast transports for dispatch purposes, carrying important, often business correspondence and light cargoes. Inbound vessels carried general mail and other correspondence and typically imported firearms, military ordnance, and paper, a simple commodity that was scarce throughout the agrarian South and badly needed by the Confederate government and general population. The Confederate Navy had a small number of its own seagoing ships used in blockade running efforts, but most of the ships employed were privately owned vessels. Many of these ships were built and designed in England by various shipping companies and other interested parties for the express purpose of getting through the blockade quickly. The ships that emerged from this enterprise were all side-wheel steamers, long and narrow vessels with a shallow draft allowing them to cut through the water more efficiently. Many were painted a dark gray color so they would blend in better with the backdrop of the night sea. A few ships were painted white to help obscure their profile against the daytime horizon while crossing great expanses of ocean. The steamers would burn normal coal that produced a dark smoke, but when they were about to approach land they would often switch to burning a smokeless anthracite coal, which greatly reduced their profile along the horizon. Sometimes these ships would use cotton soaked in turpentine as fuel, as it gave off little smoke and produced intense heat that resulted in a marked increase in ship speed. The first Confederate blockade runner left Charleston and arrived at Nassau on December 5, 1861 with 144 bales of cotton. The trip between Charleston and Nassau took a first-class steamer approximately 48 hours to complete, taking another 3 days to unload and load again and to recall. Notable blockade runners: CSS Robert E. Lee. The first Confederate ship to put to sea was the CSS Sumter, a former Spanish screw steamer of 500 tons, that was outfitted with cannons and other provisions for wartime use on April 18, 1861. Commander Raphael Semmes took command of the vessel and a dozen officers and crew. On June 30, the Sumter sailed from the mouth of the Mississippi and was promptly chased by a Union steamer, USS 52-meter steel-hulled sidewheel steamer that made a record 33 successful runs through the Union blockade, and the CSS Advance that completed more than 20 successful runs before being captured. After its capture it was renamed USS Advance in 1864 and USS Frolic in 1865. The first ship to evade the Union blockade was the A&A, a bark from Belfast, making its way from Charleston Harbor. The General Parkhill, a British ship built in Liverpool, England, was the first blockade runner to be captured by the USS Niagara, also at Charleston Harbor. Screw-driven steamers: CSS Florida 1862, Cruiser 1862-64, commissioned August 17, 1862 at Green Cay, Bahamas, commanded by Captain John Newland Moffat, sailed to Cardenas and Havana, Cuba, before making the famous run into Mobile Bay, Alabama on September 4, 1862. SS Fingal 1861, CSS Atlanta Ironclad 1862-63, and Iron Merchant screw steamer of 462 tons built by J. SS Laurel 1861-1864, a 207-foot iron-hull single-screw steamer, commanded by Lieutenant John F. Ramsey, CSN, made one successful blockade run as CSS vessel, owned by the CSA, renamed Confederate States and survived the war. CSS Sumter 1861, cruiser 1861-62, a 437-ton screw steamer cruiser, was built at Philadelphia as the merchant steamship Habana purchased by the Confederate government at New Orleans in April 1861, she was converted to a cruiser and placed under the command of Raphael Semmes. While coaling and getting supplies at Martinique, she was blockaded by Federal sloop of war USS 1865 CS Eagle of Spofford, Kent, England in 1863 for a blockade runner owned by the Charleston Importing and Exporting Company. She made her first run on November 5, 1863, running supplies from Nassau to Wilmington. The Siren completed a record 33 runs through the blockade, the most of any blockade runner. Her career as a blockade runner came to an end when the Siren, along with the other steamers Kelt, Deer and Lady Davis, were captured in Charleston Harbor at the Ashley River, where she had successfully run in through the blockade the night before. On February 18, 1865 See also, Wilmington, North Carolina in the American Civil War. Less notable blockade runners. CSS Lady Stirling was a Confederate blockade runner built by James Ashe at Cubitt Town, London in 1864. She was captured by Union forces of Wilmington on October 28, 1864. She was badly damaged and captured by the United States Navy on October 28, 1864 off Wilmington, North Carolina. Denby RMSP steamer Teviot RMSP steamer Clyde SS West Indian schooner Break O'Day steamship Columbia, iron-hulled sidewheeler steamer built by Spofford. Steamship China, Cunarder Wild Rover SS Corsica SS Will of the Wisp ran ashore on February 3, 1865 while trying to get into Galveston. CS Lillian, captured by USS 1861, ran aground and captured entering Charleston January 29, 1863. CSS General Beauregard, owned by Fraser, Trenholm. Union Navy Confederate States Navy Privateer Prize Law Letter of Marque. List of ships of the Confederate States Navy. Blockade runners. Captured ships of the American Civil War. American Civil War blockade mail of the American Civil War. Bahamas in the American Civil War. Bibliography of early American naval history. Bibliography of the American Civil War v. American Civil War. Origins. Issues. Timeline leading to the war. Antebellum era. Bleeding Kansas border states. Compromise of 1850. Dred Scott v. Sanford. Missouri Compromise. Popular sovereignty. Secession. States' rights. President Lincoln's 75,000 volunteers. Slavery. African Americans. Emancipation Proclamation. Fugitive slave laws. Slave power. Treatment of slaves in the United States. Uncle Tom's Cabin. Abolitionism. Susan B. Anthony. John Brown. Frederick Douglass. William Lloyd Garrison. Lysander Spooner. George Luther Stearns. Charles Sumner. Harriet Tubman. Underground Railroad. States. Combatants. Union. USA. Army. Navy. Marine Corps. Revenue. Cutter Service. Confederacy. CSA. Army. Navy. Marine Corps. Theaters. Eastern. Western. Lower Seaboard. Trans-Mississippi. Pacific Coast. Union. Naval Blockade. Major campaigns. Anaconda Plan. Blockade runners of the American Civil War. New Mexico. Jackson's Valley Peninsula. Northern Virginia. Maryland. Stones River. Vicksburg. Tullahoma. Gettysburg. Morgan's Raid. Bristow. Knoxville. Red River. Overland. Atlanta Valley. 1864. Bermuda Hundred. Richmond. Petersburg. Franklin. Nashville. Price's Raid. Sherman's March. Carolinas. Appomattox. Major battles. Fort Sumter. First Bull Run. Wilson's Creek. Fort Donelson. Pea Ridge. Hampton Roads. Shiloh. New Orleans. Corinth. Seven Pines. 7 days. Second Bull Run. Antietam. Perryville. Fredericksburg. Stones River. Chancellorsville. Gettysburg. Vicksburg. Chickamauga. Chattanooga. Wilderness. Spotsylvania. Cold Harbor. Atlanta. Mobile Bay. Franklin. Nashville. Five Forks. Involvement by ID Ill in IA KSKYLA ME MDMA MIMNMS MO MT NA NVNH NJNMNYNCNDOOKORPA RE SCSDTNTXUTVTVA WA WVY WAY Jackson A.S. Johnston J.E. Johnston Lee Longstreet Morgan Mosby Price Quantrill Semmes E.K. Smith Stuart Taylor Wheeler Civilian Benjamin Bakik Breckenridge Davis Hunter Mallory Memminger Seton Stevens Union Military Anderson Buell Burnside Butler DuPont Farragut Foot Fremont Grant Halleck Hooker Hunt McClellan McDowell Meade Meigs Ord Pope D.D. Porter Rosecrans Scott Sheridan Sherman Thomas Civilian Adams Chase Erickson. Hamlin Lincoln Pinkerton Seward Stanton Stevens Wade Wells